Hi folks, and welcome to your weekly recap of all things NWA Revolt here on Revolt Pro Wrestling Extra. And if you didn't know by now, I am Dan Muldoon, and we will recap all the action from Monday night. But up first, we have something of a war here for you as we see the Southern Psychopath Mance Warner take on the Tijuana Gremlin Bestia 666. Now, when I say these two men hate each other, it's an understatement. They've been going to war all over Mexico, all over the United States, and that war has landed on our doorstep here tonight in Revolt. In an unsanctioned New York City street fight, Mance Warner takes on Bestia 666. Bestia, of course, signed to Selena De La Renta's stable of talent. The NWA committee, of course, not sanctioning this fight, and it will not be recognized by the New York State Athletic Commission. There will be no referee present in the ring either. He will be calling the action from a monitor at ringside, only calling pinfalls, as there is no DQ, no rope break, anything goes, ladies and gentlemen. Here comes the Southern Psychopath, looking to unleash a few lariats and drink a few light beers tonight. But the Tijuana Gremlin looking to get this one started early as he attacks Mance. As he's making his way to the ring, attacking Mance Warner from behind. Taking him down with that flurry of strikes, finishing off with a big slap across the face of Mance Warner. Working Mance over now in the middle of the aisle. As the boos ring out from the fans, and Mance able to fight back. Walking Bestia towards the ring area. Bestia with the short elbows to the midsection. Mance taking Bestia over. Oh, and following up with that knee, much to the delight of the fans in attendance. Mance is fired up. Throwing Bestia towards the ringside area. Kick to the midsection. Another one for good measure. Setting Bestia up for a power bomb, but he's able to fight his way out with those stiff shots and follows it up with a clothesline lariat of his own. Rolls Mance Warner into the ring now. Locks in a deep camel clutch. These two do not like each other at all, folks. Mance sending Bestia over the top rope. And look at this. Oh my god! Off the apron with a powerbomb through the table that was already set up at ringside. And now what's he get? He has a chair. Making his way around the ringside area. Stalking his prey. Dramatic pause. And there it is! Hard shot from that steel chair, and Bestia is in trouble. He could be out cold here. So we hear the ref calling the pinfall, and Mance Warner has done it. He has defeated Bestia in short order. He'll be hitting that pay window tonight, folks. If you take a look back at that powerbomb through the table at ringside, and that hard chair shot. That was lights out for Bestia. Mance Warner with a few choice words for Bestia, but here come Los Parks as they attack Mance Warner, laying in the boots. Also signed to Selena De La Renta. Selena obviously not liking what she sees as she sent in the cavalry. And the first shots have been fired in what I believe is going to be a bitter, bitter war. Thank you. And next, we take a look back on all of Monday night's action. First, we're going to take a look at the footage from the brutal attack of Shane Strickland, which happened outside the arena as Strickland was trying to attend the event. Now, sources close to Shane have said he's in a stable condition and will be fit to return to action very soon. The identity of the attacker is still unknown at this time. An investigation is pending. And first in action, on Monday night we saw Austin Aries. Now Aries, something of a rocky road on his way to Revolt, with his contract signing being blocked by NWA Commissioner Jim Cornette. But Aries, approaching the committee, explained to them that he had turned a new leaf and wanted to become something of a mentor to young talent here in Revolt. The committee overruling Jim Cornette, allowing Aries to sign, and the first man to get their opportunity off Aries was that man there, Douglas James. Now, what Aries said and what he did were two different things. I'm going to show you this match in its entirety. Lasting all of 27 seconds, Aries came to the ring and proceeded to do nothing more than embarrass the young man, not giving him a chance at all. Locking in the last chancery and making short order of this one, and basically giving the middle finger to Jim Cornette and the committee, as there's nothing they could do now contracts have been signed. And following on from that, we saw action in our women's division as Santana Garrett was set to face off against Chelsea Green. Chelsea Green being very outspoken during the week, saying she couldn't possibly see how some of the talent in the women's locker room had gotten contracts here in Revolt. In particular, Santana Garrett, saying she just wasn't on her level. You know, Santana Garrett wanting to prove to the naysayers, and Chelsea Green in particular, that she does belong here. This one started out with Chelsea just disrespecting and bullying Santana around the ring, and looking very early on like she was going to finish this one quickly. We see her brutally manhandling Santana, and there putting her boot through her face. But the complexion of this one changed as the fire ignited inside Santana Garrett, making Chelsea Green eat the heel of her boot, then climbing to the top turnbuckle. Now folks, watch this one closely. You've got to admire the distance, precision and impact of that move there, and that was their turning point. There on out, Chelsea Green just could not recover, and Santana Garrett finishing up with a beautiful series of athletic maneuvers and proving her point to Chelsea Green, making her eat her words. And in our next bout of the evening, we saw the Lone Wolf of Brooklyn, Loki, take on the South African Darewolf, PJ Black. Loki would have the home field advantage in this one, of course, hailing from Brooklyn, New York. PJ Black traveling a long way to be with us, all the way from South Africa. Fine example of the international talent that Revolt Pro Wrestling has on offer. And in the early stages of this one, both men engaging in the feeling out process. Something akin to a chess match, trading move for move, hold for hold. But it would eventually be Loki's striking ability that would gain him the advantage. He took control of the match. But the Darewolf, PJ Black, able to take control back with this beautiful standing dropkick. Had the crowd in attendance worried for a short period, as it looked like he was going to overcome the challenge of Loki. Here we see a beautiful maneuver from PJ Black. Fine example of this man's ability and talent. Loki looked in trouble until this point here, where out of nowhere he hit that rolling Kapu kick and then stalked PJ Black, setting up for that signature maneuver that he likes to call Black Magic, feinting the insecurity and then driving the heel of his boot into the back of the skull of PJ Black. And to finish this one, he took a stun. PJ Black propped him up on that top turnbuckle, and in what I can only describe as an avalanche Michinoku driver, drove PJ Black to the mat and picked up the W, much to the delight of this New York City crowd. And just before our main event, we saw action from our tag team division as the team of Homicide and Eddie Kingston, Outlaws Inc., faced off against the father-son duo of LA Park and Hijo de LA Park, cornered by Selena De La Renta. Both teams looking to establish themselves within the tag team division in Revolt Pro Wrestling. Las Parks were able to gain the advantage early in this matchup, utilizing quick tags between each other. Hijo de LA Park giving a good account of himself and also gave a good account of that Lucha Libre style. LA Park and Hijo able to momentarily isolate Eddie Kingston, working him over with those double team maneuvers. Hijo taken to the air, fine display of aerial offense. But Eddie Kingston was able to fight back and make the tag to Homicide. And when Homicide came in, he was firing on all cylinders. We see a great Michinoku driver there from him. And he really assaulted Hijo de LA Park, much to the annoyance of Selena De La Renta, who was being very vocal at this point at ringside. Homicide, delighted at the annoyance of Selena De La Renta, took Hijo to the top turnbuckle, and right in front of her hit that ace crusher from the top rope. And it was at this point here that I certainly knew Los Parks were fighting a losing battle. Eddie and Homicide utilized the quick tag with great effect, working the young son of LA Park over in the corner. At this point, it just looked like Homicide and Eddie were having fun picking apart Hijo de LA Park. But at some point, Hijo was able to return some offense and alleviate the pressure with this massive tope suicida. He was then able to sweep the leg of Homicide and eventually get to his own corner and tag in LA Park. However, LA Park had as much success as Hijo did, eating that middle turnbuckle, as he received a lawn dart from Eddie Kingston, followed up by that big lariat. And then after that, it was Academic. Outlaws Inc. hitting that cop killer and making a bad night worse for Selena De La Renta and Los Parks. And then to round the night off, we had our main event, which featured the loudmouth Eli Drake taking on the Bear of Violence, John Moxley. Eli Drake engaging in a bit of psychological warfare before this one, taking to Twitter and calling out John Moxley, telling him that Eli Drake was arriving at the top of the bill, and by hook or by crook he'd be staying there. Moxley choosing not to respond and was willing to let his actions speak for him. But as we got underway, it was very clear that these men were very evenly matched. Nobody able to gain a foothold, really. Both men having to dig deep into their playbook. Crowd in attendance firmly behind the Mox. And Eli Drake figured out very early on that he was going to have to silence the crowd and take the wind out of the sails of Moxley. Moxley not willing to let that happen. Kept firing back with an answer to everything Eli Drake had for him. But after every answer came another question from Eli Drake. Drake trying everything to put this match away. For a moment it looked like he had it figured out. He attacked the neck of John Moxley on multiple occasions and silenced the crowd for a short period. Moxley got them riled up again as he came back with an onslaught and a couple of near falls. Really showed that Eli Drake was suffering in this latter stage of the match. Moxley was fired up, stalking, looking for that death rider, but Eli was able to reverse it and got Moxley up for the gravy train and had everyone in attendance worried. It was nothing more than a near fall, and as the crowd got louder and louder, Eli Drake went bigger and bigger, but the boos continued to ring out. And the chance for Moxley grew and grew as the Nassau Coliseum started to rock. Moxley, with the crowd fully behind him, went into overdrive, hitting a quick succession of moves on Eli Drake. It off. He secured that double underhook DDT that he calls the Death Rider, and much to the delight of everyone in attendance, John Moxley picked up the W in the main event.
So I shatter, no dancing, dance, nothing. Oh, my darling.